വിദേശ വിചാരത്തിൻ്റെ പ്രത്യേക പരിപാടിയായ ദ ലാസ്റ്റ് ഹസേർഡ് ടു സ്റ്റാർഡം എന്ന പരിപാടിയിലേക്ക് സ്വാഗതം. ഇത് തെരഞ്ഞെടുപ്പ് കാലമാണ്. അടുത്ത 5 വർഷം നമ്മെ ഭരിക്കാൻ സാധ്യതയുള്ള രാഷ്ട്രീയ നേതാക്കന്മാരെ പറ്റിയാണ് നാം ചർച്ച നടത്തുന്നത്. പക്ഷേ അതേസമയം തന്നെ നമ്മെ അടുത്ത 30 വർഷം ഭരിക്കാൻ പോകുന്ന ഉദ്യോഗസ്ഥന്മാരെ തിരഞ്ഞെടുക്കുന്ന ഒരു പ്രക്രിയയും ഇപ്പോൾ നടക്കുകയാണ്. ഏകദേശം 8 ലക്ഷം പേരാണ് ഈ പരീക്ഷ എഴുതിയത്. അതിൽ നിന്ന് 10,000-ത്തോളം ആളുകളെ മെയിൻ പരീക്ഷയ്ക്ക് തിരഞ്ഞെടുത്തു. അതിൽ നിന്ന് 1994 പേരെ ഇൻ്റർവ്യൂവിന് ഡൽഹിയിലേക്ക് ക്ഷണിച്ചിരിക്കുകയാണ്. അവർക്ക് കിട്ടാവുന്നത് ഏകദേശം 750 ജോലികൾ മാത്രം. ഇത്ര പ്രയാസമായ ഒരു പരീക്ഷ ലോകത്ത് എങ്ങും ഇല്ല എന്നാണ് പൊതുജനാഭിപ്രായം. ഇവർക്ക് നമ്മളുടെ വോട്ട് ആവശ്യമില്ല. അവരുടെ കഴിവുകൊണ്ട് മാത്രമാണ്, അവരുടെ പരീക്ഷയിലുള്ള അവരുടെ വിജയമാണ് അവരെ ഈ താരപഥത്തിലേക്ക് എത്തിക്കുക. അതിൽ നിന്ന് തിരഞ്ഞെടുത്ത NSS സിവിൽ സർവീസ് അക്കാദമിയിലെ മോഡൽ ഇൻ്റർവ്യൂസിൽ നിന്ന് തിരഞ്ഞെടുത്ത കാൻഡിഡേറ്റ്സിനെയാണ് ഞങ്ങൾ പരിചയപ്പെടുത്തുന്നത്. വിദേശ വിചാരത്തിൽ നമ്മുടെ ഇന്നത്തെ അതിഥി AB ശിൽപ. ഡു യു തിങ്ക് ദാറ്റ് യുവർ കമ്പ്യൂട്ടർ സയൻസ് വിൽ ഹെൽപ് യു ടു ബിക്കം എ ഫോറിൻ സർവീസ് ഓഫീസർ ഓർ എൻ IAS ഓഫീസർ? ഹൗ കെൻ യു ബ്രിങ് ഇറ്റ് ഇൻ ടു യുവർ വർക്ക്?
Technology would definitely have a great impact on the future policy, especially when we are talking about the e-governance aspects. So I believe that the graduation might be of help to me, sir.
How much computerization is there in the government today, do you know?
We are trying to computerize, though it has not been fully successful. But
half the time you don't have electricity, the other half the time the Wi-Fi doesn't work, and then you wait for the computer to come back to life. Can this be changed? Can we have a better system of computers so that we can work with it?
Sure, sir. We are all working on it because the world is trying to move very fast forward, and for that we need technology, the help of the technology. So as a result, I believe we have to adopt more innovative technologies to deal with such uncertainties when it comes to the technology, sir.
Anyway, one uncertainty is climate change.
Yes, definitely. We have had a lot of talk about how we have to deal with climate change. We have had many conferences in the past, and in 2015 Paris conference was one of the instrumental in dealing with, in addressing climate change. But with the withdrawal of United States, we have almost many people were telling that we have almost lost the hope in how we are going to deal with this particular issue, combating climate change. How do you look at the US withdrawal from Paris Agreement, and do you think that it is going to have its own ramifications upon other countries as well?
But do you believe there is climate change, or you like President Trump, you don't believe there is anything called climate change? What is your view?
I believe in climate change.
There are people who are vehemently arguing that climate change is a myth.
No, there are people who believe that the world is flat, even today.
First of all, I believe in climate change because climate change is a very serious issue which we have to combat it at any cost. So the withdrawal of US from the Paris Treaty, it would definitely have negative impacts on the world. Especially when US is one of the biggest consumer of fossil fuels, as well as US is generating the per capita emissions of GDP. It's very huge when we compare US to other countries. So in that sense, when the biggest consumer itself is withdrawing from such a treaty, that would definitely have a negative impact. Besides, US is not believing in the treaty, calling it a hoax by China. So it is focusing on the fossil fuels. Recently in the Katowice, when we had the COP24 meeting, the US government was trying to focus on the fossil fuel generation, saying that that would be a burden on the developed economies if we are having a cut on the fossil fuels. And besides, US always also believes that by giving huge amount of funds to the developing countries for the Paris deal, because there is a commitment like that.
Paris Agreement itself, do you think would save us from climate change?
It can add some positive impacts to the world, but it is not enough.
But you know, the objective is to retain the increase in temperature to 1.5 if possible, maximum 2. But according to the latest indications given by individual countries, it will be 3 degrees Celsius. So we are already finished. So what is the point in having a Paris Agreement?
So it is always better to have something rather than to have nothing. So I believe even when the IPCC, they said that there is an imminent danger which is coming as the world is moving to the 3 degrees Celsius temperature, and we may not be able to combat the climate change with the Paris deal itself. But I would say that Paris deal is a big step towards something.
US is the second largest emitter of carbon dioxide and all, and China is the first. But with the withdrawal of US, prospects are bleak.
I think the population is that huge, so that the per capita
emission is very low for China and India. So what is it that finally can save us? Paris Agreement is not going to save us. Technologically, is it going to be possible for one day for us to wipe out carbon dioxide from the atmosphere? Will it be possible? Is it scientifically, science fiction, is it possible?
So we are focusing these days on the geoengineering aspects. For example, we are focusing on the aerosols, spraying aerosols to ensure that there is no change to the monsoon. So such technological innovations could bring some positive effects in the short term. But on the long term, I would say that we have to have a restraint or constraint when it comes to the emissions. We have to ensure that the carbon footprint which we release, it is always very minimal. Even though there should be a balance between the development as well as dealing with climate change.
It is high time we have to move towards renewable energy.
Yes,
including
and,
nuclear.
Yes. Different solar energy, wind energy, different sorts of renewable energy mechanisms. Are you aware that we have a national action plan on climate change? India has a national action plan on climate change.
And also the Solar Alliance.
Solar Alliance.
Britain is in the process of exiting from European Union.
Is it?
Yes. It's going on. Huge discussions. And
yeah,
Prime Minister May facing a lot of issues there in the parliament.
That's why I was asking.
And do you think that they are really going to go out, and how it is going to impact the world, especially Indian economy?
Brexit, Britain's exit from the European Union, it is something which is unpredictable, and the whole world is looking for how it is going to deal with it.
Because there's a new word called Brextinction. Stop Brexit.
Because the Brexit, the entire topic on Brexit came from a very small margin of referendum. The people in Britain, there was a very small margin, with a very small margin they voted for Brexit. And there was already some accusations or allegations that most of the people who vote for Brexit, they don't know how or what is in fact Brexit or how it is going to impact the European economy or Britain. So such uncertainties are there when it comes to Brexit, but definitely it is having both positive impacts as well as negative impacts when we when we consider the case of how India is going to deal with Brexit. Because the positive impacts are that for years we have been trying to have a foreign trade agreement with the European Union. Though we have signed certain agreements in 2002 and 2003, we are not been able to realize it because there have been certain restrictions. For example, the phytosanitary restrictions, and such restrictions have been imposed on India, which the country is trying to find it very difficult to cope with. So in that sense, this Britain's exit, it might provide a door for India to have certain relations, more positive relations with the British, because even though European Union, we might not be able to have such a great impact on the European Union, but with Britain, because Britain needs to have certain markets in case it is having a dearth from the European markets. So in that case, Britain might try to see a positive ally in India. So that is one positive aspect of Brexit for India.
There are certain inherent problems are there in European Union, and what measures that India should do for tapping the maximum benefits which is going to come out because of Brexit?
We need to forge alliance with Britain, that's the first thing, and also forging alliances with European Union, because the Brexit, the Britain's exit would leave a vacuum in European Union, and European Union would definitely be interested to fill that vacuum. So India needs to use that opportunity to ensure that we are realizing a trade agreement with the European Union as well as with Britain. And besides, there are a lot of software companies or there are IT services in Britain and European Union. So we have to ensure that with Britain's exit, the gateway to European Union might be closed for such companies. So in that case, we have to realize an agreement with the European Union to ensure that our service sector industry is also getting benefits from that.
Do you think that this can, if Brexit happen, which can trigger global economic crisis?
Sir, it is quite unpredictable. Given Britain might choose a soft exit or Britain might choose a hard exit.
Tell us so what these are. What is the difference between a soft exit and a hard exit?
Sir, in case of hard exit, there won't be any agreement with the European Union. That would mean there would be the breaking of ties between Britain and European
Without
Union.
Without any
future arrangements or arrangements, sir. But when it comes to soft Brexit, it means that there will be certain arrangements to ensure that the trade is carried out smoothly, especially through the using Ireland as the gateway. So such kind of arrangements would be there in this case of soft Brexit, sir.
How European Union responded to the refugee crisis?
Different countries were responding in different manner. For example, the countries like Britain, they were very much skeptical about the migration issue because they were saying it is having a crunch on their resources, this migration. And whereas on the other hand, there are certain countries like Germany, which has been supporting some form of migration to ensure that there is some legal framework agreement which is in place to ensure that migration is being carried out very smoothly. Also, there are certain
Germany concerns. Germany was very much welcoming when it comes
to refugees.
But what about other countries? In total, European Union as a whole, how it was responding?
Do you think
that they were successful in accommodating the refugees, or what was the kind of arguments?
No, ma'am, not really. They were have succeeded in it, because there is an agreement like that. The first country where the refugees arrive, it is where they have to file for the accommodation and all. So in that case, mostly they come to the Spain and such countries which are very nearby. Italy and all. So in that case, there has been concerns from such country that the refugee influx into such countries are more than how much they could accommodate. So such concerns, if they are not addressed properly, it might lead to some tensions in the European Union.
In the case of Britain itself, they were upholding nationalism. So
you know, ma'am.
They have their own reservations in accommodating refugees more.
Okay, Shilpa, let's go back to the United States for a while. And President Trump, the most discussed national leader ever in history. Now, he has two more years to go, and he has some successes, many failures, but he always takes chances. So, nobody knows when Mr. Trump will cease to be president, whether he will end with this term or we'll have a next term. When he was elected, there was no expectation of a second term. These days, there is an expectation that he may still win another election. And we do not have a strong Democratic candidate as yet. So what is your prediction on this? Do you think President Donald Trump will survive the next election?
Sir, the election of President Trump as the president itself, it was surrounded by many of the accusations and allegations of
nobody expected him to be president in the first place.
Yeah, definitely, sir. Because there were such allegations that there has been manipulations in elections, and there were allegations on role played by social media, especially the Cambridge Analytica incident, which pointed out that there had to be something which was working in the social media, which had resulted in the success of Mr. Trump as the president of USA.
And Hillary Clinton had more votes, popular votes.
Yes, sir. But still, Trump became the president. So in that case, the second term of Trump is very unpredictable. But I need to say that as a president, Trump was trying to ensure that whatever things which he had put in the election manifesto, he's trying to fulfill that.
America first.
Yeah, America first policy. So even though there is negative impacts on the whole world because of the Trump's certain policies like the withdrawal from the Paris Treaty, withdrawal from the Trans-Pacific Partnership,
Jerusalem.
I mean, making Jerusalem the considering it as the capital of Israel, and the recent issue of withdrawal from Syria and Afghanistan, which are on talks, they withdrawal from the INF Treaty. So these are certain areas where the whole world is concerned. But still, since there is a populist rise of identity politics,
but it is the Americans who are going to vote, not
us.
Yeah,
they are going. They might vote for the Trump because for them it is.
What are the reasons for that? Why are the Americans kind of inclined to elect him?
So first of the thing is that in the whole world, the identity politics is playing a role right now. So for them, America First policy is a welcome sign to ensure that their employments are saved and their economy is saved. So in that sense, they might consider Trump as a savior for them. So that is one aspect for that. And second is that the recent trade wars, though people doesn't know the current impact of trade wars, they believe that by having imposing restrictions on the Chinese goods,
you're controlling China.
Yeah, by controlling China, it will benefit America, though in reality it is not. So For such aspects, I believe the people, if they are not judicious enough or if they are not having a proper, they are deciding not based on evidence, it might turn out to be a favor for Mr. Trump's.
You would have heard that, you know, a lot of people are talking about alternate currencies or digital currencies in the world. Other than this country's nationals having their own currency, if we can have a common currency, digital currency, like bitcoins, it will be helpful and it is better. What do you think about this?
The digital currencies like the Bitcoin, Ethereum, these are certain currencies which make use of the blockchain technology, which is having a very decentralized database, which is also secure. We cannot say it is foolproof, but still it is secure. So it is making use of such technology to ensure that
what are the arguments in favor of that?
First of all, there won't be any boundaries between the nations because we'll be having a common digital currency.
No governments involved.
Yeah, no governments involved. But that is a negative, in fact. But still, no governments will be involved. And it will be very convenient for people because they don't have to carry the cash in their wallet. It will be having a digital wallet.
But don't you think that governments has to involve and control currency?
But yes, In India, it's already banned. That means government has already intervened.
Because when time comes, when there is a problem, like what happened now through budget, they are pushing 4 lakhs crores of rupees extra, reducing interest rate by Reserve Bank of India. So like that, don't you think that the governments or authorities has to intervene in currency making?
Sir, I believe that the government has to intervene in because the case of Bitcoin itself, the currency is very much volatile because one second it would be having the value, much higher value, but the next second it might go down. So such high volatility and high unpredictability shows that government needs to intervene when it comes to such currencies. Without government intervention, we cannot call it a global currency as such because it is could be subjected to manipulations.
Then what is the difference between Bitcoin and the normal currency?
Only difference which I can see in it is that the Bitcoin is a digital currency and which is based on a certain algorithm which ensures that it could be used for the transactions, especially when it comes to e-commerce industry, and people are finding it more favorable to the having cash on hand, sir. So that is one thing which makes people feel that Bitcoin is more favorable. And especially when it comes to the currency volatility, people believe that even though it is taking risk in investing in the Bitcoins, but since there is a volatility aspect, it might go in favor for them as well. So this is one aspect which is attracting people to the Bitcoin.
How about India-Pakistan relations, finally? What do you think is the solution? If you find a solution for the Kashmir problem, you will get the Nobel Peace Prize. can you attempt one?
Again, an election, the topic will come up now.
Sir, I believe we have to find an amicable solution when it comes to the case of Kashmir. Mm-hmm. Because 4 years we have been fighting for the Kashmir issue, as well as there has been an infiltration of terrorists to our boundaries. The way which they find us, the LOZ area or the area of the Pak occupied Kashmir, through them the terrorists are entering India, and which is causing a great headache for the country.
No, that's the problem. I want the solution.
So I believe we need to move forward with the bilateral talks. For example, we have to take both track when diplomacy.
But our policy is different. We cannot have bilateral talks unless they stop terrorism. And they will not stop terrorism unless we start bilateral talks. So where do we go?
Sir, the solution is a bit difficult to implement, but
how about the LOC as international border?
Yes, sir, that is definitely a great option. But even for that, we have to ensure that there is a consensus from the case of Pakistan as well, which is very difficult to arrive at. But I'm sure that one day we'll be able to achieve it as well.
How do you look at the new Prime Minister in Pakistan and how he is going to deal with the situation?
Will he play cricket? You know what cricket means? Good behavior. That is what cricket is all about. But does he play cricket in politics?
Till now, he's been showing very positive signs regarding the developments, because of the recent case of the Kadapur corridor. Mm-hmm. It is something which showed a positive sign that Pakistan is even willing to have talks with India. So I believe we could be optimistic regarding. Yes, ma'am, definitely.
No, but they are not willing to stop terrorism. That is the problem. They are willing to talk, but they would like to have talk and terrorism at the same time, which is unacceptable.
India needs to have a carrot and stick policy when it comes to dealing with Pakistan. Because
surgical strikes.
Yeah, we need to have a control on the terrorist aspect. We need to ensure that terrorists don't get an opportunity to infiltrate into a country or disturb the country's peace in any manner. But at the same time, we have to ensure that parallelly, we'll be having diplomatic talks with Pakistan to ensure that the Kashmir issue gets solved?
Anyway, please prepare a plan by the time you go to the UPSC. Then you might, instead of being taken to the civil service, you might be given the Nobel Prize.
Yeah.
All the very best.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, sir.
So what do you think? You think she'll find a solution for Kashmir problem?
We had a very pleasant, very friendly interview. Like other two candidates, we had a very friendly interview with her. She was very patient throughout her conversational style. Yes, very much. I didn't feel like we were actually interviewing her.
Well, that is the secret of this interview. Mm. If you can make it into a conversation, rather than a question
like
and answer. And that is what I advise all our aspiring civil servants, that if you fall into a question-answer session, then the question of right answers and wrong answers. In this case, there are no right answers and wrong answers. They were expressing their opinions.
Yeah, this is a personality test. The personality has to come out ultimately instead of a question-answer session. Also, she's having a lot of confidence.
Yes.
I found it like, you know, I mean,
she was smiling throughout.
And then she doesn't have any kind of like fear or anything. Just like, I hope she will do same thing before the original interview board also.
Mm. Very good. So we should be we should be happy that she's done so well.
Yeah.
All right. Videsha Vijayarathinte Pratyeka Paripadiyaya Tharapathathilekulla Avasanathe Kadampa Enna Paripadi Avasanikkukayanu. നമസ്കാരം.